and welcome to Crossbridge Wellness Affiliates. I'm the owner, Lynn Aquafondata, and we have a very special video for you today. Each month, our affiliates get together. We are a group of licensed and board certified wellness professionals from a variety of disciplines, and we get together and take turns sharing something from our own professional work with each other so that we can learn not just what each other's does, but also learn from each other so that we can become better clinicians. This month, Ben Pirro shared about his work as a bodywork professional. He shared about how he does an assessment, and we would like to share this video with you. Enjoy.
Take a quick look at that. I'm more concerned with this okay. and the fact that you said you grind your teeth or your jaws tight.
Yeah.
Would you mind lying down? Head this way?
Head this way. Okay.
If you don't mind. Because you said your knee was bugging you. You might. So, the first thing I'm going to do is just scan her body. Okay? I'm just going to kind of go down and just check areas that I tend to look for, that I know tend to hold this sympathetic charge, we'll call it. Okay, for lack of a better term. And the goal is that pretty much every place I touch, if she's lying down and she's at complete rest, there should be no problem with me pressing anywhere, and every joint should just have a nice easy bounce to it. A nice easy glide to it, at least. All right? Go ahead and rest. Nervous? That's a fight or flight response.
Uh-oh.
Mine are too, though, so. All right. No real, what's called the subtalar joint. I can turn this way and there's a little bit of motion. This way is barely any.
Yeah, it's affecting my balance.
Okay. It's throwing her foundations off. Think about it that way. Her foundation's off, it makes sense that which came first. You know, I don't know, but if your foundation's off, it makes sense that the rest of the body's going to have to compensate for that, right? Now that one has a little bit more this way, but it has none coming in, right? So it's opposite. Both of them need to be freed up a little bit, though. Does it bother your feet bother you?
There's a trigger point on the other side.
Don't worry about trigger points. It'll be gone by the time we get done with this. That's the beauty of it. Trigger point therapy, they teach us to dig right into it and push on, hope it dissipates, and then half an hour comes right back.
It's a nightmare.
Trigger point's a symptom. It's never a cause, it's a symptom.
That's
it's the body
thing.
Telling you something.
That's a good thing to know.
Yeah.
Right.
I mean, from a counsel perspective, it's the same thing. We use the trigger point as the symptom.
The problem is they're still teaching all this stuff, everybody and students just to dig into them and instead of really you're treating the same thing.
I even do it with a roller.
You can, it's all right to release them, but you can't figure out anything else to do. Give yourself relief, right?
Yeah.
But let's try to get the cause of the trigger point.
Yeah.
Okay. Put your toes up towards your head. Hold right there. Just hold. I'm going to go just like that. I'm just releasing. So really what I'm doing right now is trying to release your calf muscles, right? Using reciprocal inhibition, using these muscles to try to reciprocally inhibit these, okay? Try to keep that there, but try to separate your toes if you can. There you go. Using this muscle, which in my theory, I think it's a little bit the static nerve, right? It's why this messes with the nerve, the spine, what's the phrase for it, being rested. The spinal modulation as the reflex comes in and out kind of gets it to dampen down a little bit. Can you feel the difference already?
Yeah.
Right? And I haven't even done what I really wanted to do to really say yeah. Same thing.
Wow.
Same thing, okay?
Yeah.
But it's not perfect, but it's better. You have a fascial restriction right there. You feel that?
A fascial restriction.
There's a thickening in her fascia right there. So let's just see if we can correct that with this. Hold right there. Yep, got it?
Yep.
Stimulating both sides, trying to get both muscles on each side. I think it's doing a little bit more than this, but for simplicity's sake, I'm trying to get both muscles to fire on that. I'm right on the tendons of the muscles that come to break down to the side of the ankle, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, rest. Okay. There you go. Can you see that?
Yeah.
Wow.
Now, subtalar joint is this one right here. That's really what I'm looking at. Does that feel much better that's moving?
Yeah.
Don't be surprised your ankles crack a little bit. When I say crack, there's seven bones that fit in there and they all have to glide on each other. Some of those are locked up, they're going to start falling back into place. Okay? It's a beauty, but we don't have to force anything to happen. Hopefully the body will relax and allow everything to fall back into place. Okay? So So now we gotta do the same thing over here. Let's use this as our baseline now, right? It's actually doing pretty good, but let's do it anyway so we get just a little bit extra hold right there.
What happens when you do this, when you tap?
I think there's a bunch of things that are happening. Rest for a second. How I just explained it though, that you got the muscles that come down, mm-hmm. your tip posterior here, your tip anterior here, as well as the all your peroneals that come down. They work opposite of each other. I'm trying to get them both to fire at the same time, right on the tendons, and the tendons have the little stretch receptors, and every time you tap, it creates like a little firing. Okay. Mm-hmm. I also think, and we can talk about this as well, as it gets out of the PERT stuff, but bone is very piezoelectric.
That's interesting, because that actually hurt.
Okay.
You're tapping.
On the inside or the outside?
On the outside, which it didn't on that.
Okay.
It felt kind of hot.
Right there, feel that?
Yeah.
Before you had this here, you got a little bit right there, too. So let's just see. Now, again, I'm going to.
You talked about that earlier.
Yep.
Now that.
Right there.
Is very
tender. Right? I didn't bring my reflex hammer now, but let's see if I can get it without it. Hold right there. Any problems with that? Like you're turning out?
No.
Good. Hold that for me. I almost suspect that her fibula, which is this bone, is actually not gliding correctly on this side. We'll make it to that in a minute. Okay, rest. Does that feel? Feel any difference?
Well, I don't think you're pressing as hard.
I'm pressing probably twice. Can you see how much I'm moving your leg? All right.
Well, this is how it works.
if it feels
better.
If it doesn't hurt, you should be able to sink right in. That's the beauty of it. Pressing you easily twice
different.
As hard, right? Trying to paraphrase this as best I can. This whole thing is that you discover through his practice that we release muscle, we can release fascia, we can release nerves. Why aren't we releasing these primal reflexes that are naturally ingrained with us and that work on an unconscious level, that they're whether you want them there or not. So what he's found is they tend to get locked on, especially after a big stutter event or a big pain event. My take on all of this is really what he's doing is bringing the sympathetic system and the parasympathetic system into a better balance. The body's always trying to find this balance. Well, I think most of us here can agree, we live in this world where the sympathetic's taking over, right? So if we can get anything else that's down, out of the way of that balance to try to bring the body to better homeostasis, that's what I think is happening with this approach.
So how would you, not being a massage person, how would you define the sympathetic?
Sympathetic is your stress, your fight or flight response, flight, freeze response, right?
Yeah.
Your parasympathetic is the pretty much the opposite of that. Your rest, relaxation, that's where all your homeostasis tends to be regulated. Now, it's not supposed to be one side or the other. You need to have this constant balance. But like I just said, we live in such a world where we're such fast-paced. We got all kinds of stresses that we're not supposed to be dealing with. We're designed to be hunting and gathering food from the time we wake up till the time we rest. But we're running to the grocery store, we got to take the kids to the school, we got to pay bills, we got to do all these different things, and your nervous system doesn't distinguish menial stresses versus life-threatening. It's all life-threatening. So your system is always trying to fight that, and we're living way up here, and it's never able to get back down. Should say never. There's very few people that are able to do it. If you were, say, a Buddhist monk that meditated for 20 hours a day and had no other stresses in your world, because you're supposed to have some stress, you might fall into that category, but it's very few that don't at least present with the minimum amount of the stuff that we look for with this program. And I don't even like to call it a program because it's really a way of looking at the body. It's not really a protocol. It's assessing and going off our assessments and then trying to figure out, where to go with it. And it looks odd to begin with. When you first see it, it does look odd. Lynn can attest for it, right? When I first saw it, I was like, this stuff's out there, but it seems to work. And then when it works really well. He has a track record of saying it works about 80% of the time. Okay.
Hmm.
Not many therapies can say it works 80% of the time. Now, also what he means by 80% is whether it holds or not, right? So you might not have wig out the table and 80% better, but that should start holding. There's many different reasons why it might not hold, and we can try to get into some of those if you want, but big ones are like dehydration, like a true structural abnormality, where you're not fixing structure. heavy metal toxicities, any type of nutritional deficiencies can have a big